Hey folks, how's it going? Dr. Spin, Eclectic Album Reviews, and Gentle Musical Meanderings. I got another album appetizer roundup for you guys. And of course, these are all very brief looks at some albums I've just kind of been listening to recently. But these albums are going to have a really big importance in the coming months. So if you're interested in new music, now's a really good time. Jump on board and then follow me as in the next few months and see how these things play out. Okay, but for today, we're going to start off with Freestyle Fellowships, To Whom It May Concern. This sort of era of hip-hop before about 1993 when Dr. Dre came on and kind of made hip-hop a little bit more publicly acceptable. There's really interesting things that were happening during that time, and that's kind of my favorite era of hip-hop. And a couple of years ago I did some work with Public Enemy and thinking about that album, and this is from that same era, pre the Chronic. During that time, of course, like a lot of hip-hop artists were trying to make it work just like anybody else. And so their solution to the problem of getting a record deal is to pool their resources, their financial resources and their talents and their skills, and produce this album. Way before the Wu-Tang Clan kind of started doing the same thing. This album came up on a Bandcamp recommendation because it was just recently re-released, and so I'm listening to the re-released recording and it sounds fantastic.
On my couch watching the boob tube, fighting like a roughneck just to stay loose, as I sat and wrote rhymes on a page like Mother Goose. This was the problem, results of a test. The heart of all whackness lies rooted out west, right smack dab inside my civilization. The hunt for an MC brings investigation. What I mean is basically there's no one who comes off correct and stands in the sun of Cal, but here comes the change up in trend, the world debut intro to the Sunshine Men.
So in general, Freestyle Fellowship's message is pretty positive, pretty socially conscious, and talk about the same things that we've been talking about for the past 50 to 100 years in the black community. We still see those things happening back then. In 1991, and being a voice for a whole, you know, group of people, but trying to take it in more of a positive and artistic direction. And this era of hip hop also is sort of characterized by very rhythmic, very groove oriented lyric approach, and that's the basis of my favorite kinds of rap style. Next, I have Juliana Barwick's "Healing Is a Miracle." Interestingly, her style lies sort of like somewhere on the spectrum between like Enya, in a way, and Sigur Rós. And I don't mean that as a diss Enya, because I think that actually Enya had some really important things to say, and was really important sonically at the time that she came out, and kind of got lost in the sort of new age hyper-positivity, and so she kind of got a bad rap. But really, she was doing some interesting things musically at that time and textually. Juliana Barwick's doing a lot of that same sort of thing, but I think with a little bit more contemporary approach, like her whole idea is looping and vocal effects. Now, my initial impression of this album was it was very smooth and very atmospheric and very soothing. But as I've delved into it more, I think there's actually quite a bit more grit in this album than I initially gave it credit for, especially in terms of some of the synthesizer sounds that she uses. So a lot of her sounds are based on just her voice and ways that she manipulates her voice. But there are other sounds that are going on in there, and I really appreciate this kind of sawtooth wave sounds that she has going on, especially in the bass, and it gives it the music a little bit more menace than initially is apparent. So deceptive album, I think some good stuff going on with it too. Next up is Perfect Beings, Vier. This is kind of a funny story too, because I got this album right when I was kind of getting into Cynic, because I heard that it was a very prog rock style album, but that Sean Reinhart from Cynic was playing drums with these guys, and got the album, was really blown away by it, but found out that Sean Reinhart actually joined the band after this album was recorded, so he's not actually on this recording, but I can definitely see how his style of drumming would fit really, really well with what these guys are doing.
The mutated transposition regenerated life. Enter the center, the center, the center. Enter the center.
the album is set up in four big multi-movement epics. And so as such, there's a lot going on with it. This is an album I think that has requires multiple listenings just to grasp everything that's happening with it. But it's not just random. There's a lot of very smart songwriting going in this. And I mean progressive rock songwriting, like taking themes from the beginnings and ends of epics and tying things together, not just making five separate things, but making a whole cohesive piece out of different material. That's where the best prog rock lies. And I think that's what these guys are doing on this album quite a bit. There's kind of a sense you could compare these guys to Yes to a degree, but I also feel like that their sound is very streamlined and very contemporary. And finally, I got The Caretakers, An Empty Bliss Beyond This World. Very interesting recording, and the description of this recording is really what made me decide to check it out. The sound artist Leland Kirby, whose pen name is The Caretaker, got a hold of some old shellac records, pre-World War II, like ballroom dancing stuff, and started doing a study on dementia and how people who are suffering from dementia kind of recall the past in little snippets and kind of whitewashed things, but how they seem very vivid. And what he's done on this album that's really interesting is not a whole lot of like flat-out musicianship that goes on in this, but definitely how the production works makes this an incredibly haunting and in some ways kind of terrifying work if you think about what he's trying to do. I didn't know very much about An Empty Bliss Beyond This World before I discovered it and recently found it. So apparently there's a lot of studies that's been done on this album, particularly in terms of nostalgia and memory and again, like the perception of what it might be to be a person suffering with dementia and how you do recall the past. So I'm not going to add to that conversation just yet without reading a whole bunch more stuff, but I can tell you that when you listen to this album, especially on headphones, and you keep in mind that it's supposed to kind of capture the experience of a person losing their memory, losing their past, and trying to put it back together in patches, it's a pretty disturbing piece, even though it's very soothing and very mellow on the surface. It's the concept that really pushes this album beyond just its superficial successes. Okay, that's all I got for you guys this week. Please check out all these recordings. If you like this video, please like and subscribe. Share it out with your friends. Also follow me over on Spotify. I'll be putting more stuff up for the 2022 playlist. And until you see you next time, I'll catch you on the flip side.